Our next presenter is Emma Kowal. Emma is a graduate student in Chris Burge's lab. She grew up in Toronto and did her undergraduate work in chemical and physical biology at Harvard before crossing vast distances to come to MIT. Her dream was to write science fiction, and so she decided she'd better study science so she would know what to write about. The title of Emma's talk is Gone But Not Forgotten, How Do Introns Enhance Gene Expression? Emma.
Ask a biologist how cells turn DNA into protein, and I bet they'll say to you, oh yeah, we know how that works. Imagine you're a cell, and I'm your DNA. I'm going to hand you a 10-page instruction manual on how to build some protein. But before I give it to you, I'm going to rip out 9 of the pages and say, oh, you actually need that one. That's how human genes work. They synthesize a whole big long message and then throw away most of it before it actually gets to the protein factory, the ribosome. So now knowing that, imagine I'm the cell and you're a molecular biologist. Say you want me to make a ton of some protein. Maybe you want to study it, maybe you want to use it as a drug. What are you going to do? You're going to give me a ton of DNA, right? But hey, you're scientists, you're clever. You're not going to waste your time making that whole big long message when most of it's just going to get thrown away, right? You could just give me the little pieces that go to the ribosome called the exons, and that should work, right? Well, in that case, I, the cell, would turn around and say, here's your protein, smartass, and just give you a little bit, or sometimes none at all. What's up with that? Well, you should have given me the whole gene, because those bits that get cut out, they're called introns, and it turns out that even though they don't contain instructions on how to build a protein, even though they literally get destroyed seconds after they're built in the cell, most genes need at least one intron for effective protein production. How is this possible? Well, that's what I'm going to try and figure out. One question that you might start with is, does it matter what's in the intron? Does the intron sequence matter, or is it just ripping something out that's important for the cell? Well, now picture two cells. You give them the same gene, same exons, two different introns. Cell one gets intron A, cell two gets intron B. Who makes more protein? Well, people have done this experiment. You know what they saw? Sometimes it doesn't really matter. Sometimes one intron will give you 500 times more protein than the other. So here's my plan. Instead of two cells, I'm going to take 1,000,000 cells. I'm going to give them each the same gene with a different intron. 1,000,000 different introns, each with a unique randomly generated sequence. Then I'm going to measure and see who makes the most protein and what intron sequences differentiate the strong introns from the weak. Because what I want is like a Rosetta Stone for the intron code. I want to learn a few words of their language and then use them to ask what introns are up to in the cell. Who are their partners in crime? What mysterious chemistry allows them to speed up production in a factory that they will never touch? Because I think the problem is, we already speak the language of exons. You know, we know the genetic code, how DNA goes to protein, whatever. We think that's the whole story. But we have no idea what those introns might be whispering in the ear of the ribosome long after they're gone. And I think it's about time we started to listen, because I bet they have a lot to say. Thank you.